everybody. You are listening to Duncan and Doonkeen. We are your hosts, myself, Drew Duncan, and of course, as always, with me is Thyme Doonkeen. Do not forget that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Duncan Doonkeen. And do not forget that we are wherever you are listening to podcasts. Simply tell your device to play Duncan and Doonkeen on Spreaker, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google, Apple Podcasts. We are wherever you are listening to podcasts. Folks, we have plenty to get to today. Obviously, we're going to be talking about UFC 251. We're going to be talking about our favorite sports movies of all time. And additionally, Thyme Doonkeen herself is coming off an official experience with COVID-19. We're going to get into that a little bit later on in the program as well. Thyme, I just want to say I am so glad that you and yours are all safe after your quarantine.
Thank you so much. I'm finally cleared, so I haven't been out of my house in 3 weeks. I've never seen this color on my skin before. It says I look a little vampirish. Well, I'm ready to leave the house. Well, see me. I'm like a teenager that just turned 18.
Man, and I did see you in the car, by the way, which was an incredible sign. And you guys were out doing baseball stuff and things like that with your daughter, who, by the way, caught a delicious baseball right to the schnoz. Glad she's okay after that ferocious hit.
You know, we don't block baseball bats with our face. So maybe that sank in.
Well, lesson learned, let's put it that way. All right here, Thyme, really quick, let's get into it. UFC 251, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Obviously the ugly. Let's start with that being the main event. That was about as entertaining as watching two goats walk around in a circle. Greatest foot stomper of all time at this point is Usman. Any explanation for that fight on your end? I personally don't see one.
It was hard to watch. Yeah. It was grueling, you know. But initially I picked Usman to win just because, you know, Masvidal had so many factors against him. Anytime you take a main event fight for UFC on 6 days' notice, you're already an underdog. I don't care what your record is. So, I mean, he came in 6 days' notice on a quarantine. I don't care what you say. That's gangster shit. I mean, I have no doubt. And on top of pulling 20 pounds. So, you know, do I think that Gamebred can take him on a full fight camp? Oh, yeah. Everybody does. Everybody can see that now, that Masvidal would be.
Okay,
but I feel Masvidal would be a better fighter with the full fight camp and enough notice.
But he couldn't get out for that cage. I mean, let's just be honest. Usman put him on the cage and dared him to pull him off. He couldn't do it. He couldn't get out of it. I don't really give. And look, I'm not going to say that the weight loss dramatically didn't play a role into that, obviously, because you're gonna, you know, all of your stamina's in your thighs and your muscles of brain as well, and so all those factors begin to come into play. But let's be honest, if you can't push a guy off of the cage enough, and you know, Gamebred, you know, Masvidal, give him some credit, he came out of some holds. There were a couple of times where he gave his back up and he was able to figure out a way to weasel his way out of there. But overall, let's just be honest, the strength factor was not there by his own bidding. And then the other factor to me was, you figure out you're not exactly a great grappler. You figure out you're an okay wrestler. And what he was relying on was that one dramatic punch, which, by the way, Usman was ready for. He was clearly ready for that knee shot, right? Because we saw him evade that. So at some point, we got to give credit where credit is due, because Jorge Masvidal himself said, no excuses, Usman won the fight. And so let's keep it very real here for just a moment. If you can't get a guy off of you and let him, you know, you're getting muscled on the cage like that. I know we think it's ugly. It was boring. But let's be honest, Usman said, you're not going to be able to beat me with your fist. You're going to have to figure out another way. And basically said, you're a one-dimensional fighter. And I think that that was proved to a certain extent.
Yeah, but he still took him to decision with the short notice fight, pulling that much weight. And 20 pounds is average. That's about the average to lose to cut on a fight camp, but usually you do it over a 2-week period. You cut over a month or however long,
but time,
you cut it in 1 week.
You and I both know that these guys. But time, come on, you and I both know. Number one, there's the gradual cut. Number two, let's be very honest about this as well. All right, you can't expect to drop that kind of weight and then be a factor in any fight. That's number three. And then, of course, we see what 1FC has been doing, which is you're fighting at more, you're walking around weight. So, you know, Masvidal wanted more money. Paige Van Zandt was screaming at more money long before a lot of other people were. You know, last year, I think it was September, August, somewhere in that neighborhood where she came out and said she wanted more money, claims that she was making more money by taking pictures of herself on Instagram than she was fighting for the UFC. She gets beat in the first round, unimpressive fight. So let's be honest, the people that are saying, I want more money, are the ones who are seemingly unable to perform when it really matters the most, regardless of the circumstance. Look, Masvidal took that fight knowing exactly what was on the line. We all know that he had got jumped for the contendership. Went ahead and decided to go ahead and step up. You can call it gangster shit all you want to. I'm just going to go ahead and call it irresponsible. Period.
You said irresponsible?
Absolutely.
I don't think it. I think that he's a game opponent, and I think that he's a gangster. And game bred is fitting for his name. And for everyone that said it was a boring fight, you're probably right. It was boring. But what you saw is two fighters on a good defense game. He still took a second-degree black belt in BJJ to decision.
But is that really...
Mic drop.
Not really, because think about it. Usman was willing to go to a decision predicated upon the way that he was fighting. And you and I both know that. He was testing the waters. And at the end of the fight... We saw him get a little bit lax, and that was when we saw Masvidal take a couple of shots and almost put him down, but almost doesn't cut the mustard. You and I both know that, and that was in the last 20 seconds of that fight. So that doesn't even really count. So the bottom line to me is Usman was very willing to let it go the distance, wear Masvidal down, maybe get a submission. There was no game plan to me of I'm going to put him on the ground, period. And it worked.
Right.
Whether we like it or not, it did work. Mic drop.
Well, I don't want to see a rematch. I don't want to see that fight again.
Yeah, me either.
But, you know, this is what everybody wanted. Everybody wanted this Masvidal Usman fight to take place. That's what the crowd wanted. That's what the fans were begging for. So that's what we got. So now we got to look for the next fight for Usman. The next fight for Masvidal, because Masvidal still has a belt.
And no, Masvidal's got the BMF belt, which doesn't really count. I mean, come on, he beat. Let's think about this for a second. Who he beat? Nate Diaz, once revered as a highly promotable, incredible fighter from the streets, worked his way up. Did a lot of things, called out Conor McGregor, but let's remember that he beat Conor McGregor on short notice, and then with a full fight camp, McGregor won that fight. I don't care what anybody says. It's fairly debatable, but to me, it's not. McGregor won that fight hands down. When all was said and done, Nate Diaz looked like he'd been mauled by a tiger. All right, let's look at the fight record of Nate Diaz and Jorge Masvidal for that record. Both of them are in double-digit losses. But at least Masvidal can look at his record, and he's won, what, 16 more fights, somewhere in that neighborhood, than Nate Diaz. The BMF belt was nothing more than a marketing strategy that Dana White used because he needed a way to promote this fight. He did a great job of bringing in The Rock. He did a great job of adding these kind of WWE entertainment elements and all that kind of stuff. But when all was said and done, what does the BMF belt prove when you're not even a champion and you haven't been a champion and you're never going to be a champion? Period.
Diaz has taken some high-level fights.
High level, but how well has he performed in those fights, though? Come on,
Ty. The reason why he doesn't have a stacked record like Masvidal is because he's unmarketable, and he's always trash-talking Dana White. So, yeah, Dana White isn't going to put him in.
Come on, there's a lot of people who trash-talk Dana White and get good fights. Come on, he let Paige Van Zandt, on a main card against a 9-1 fighter, knowing she had an 8-4 record, with one fight remaining on her contract, and said, okay, I'm going to give you a main card, despite all the injuries, despite all the surgeries, despite the blasting him and the Instagram thing that I talked about, despite claiming that she made more money on Dancing with the Stars and all this stuff. She wanted more money. And then Dana White's like, okay, look, you'll lose convincingly in the first round. Go ahead and test the market with free agency at 8-5 to Bellator for you. Hell, maybe not even Bellator. Let's be honest. Shamrock FC, Invicta at best. Come on, Thyme. You know better than this.
You know, I like Paige VanZant as an entertainer. I don't know that I like her as a fighter.
Who does like her as a fighter?
She can take a hit like nobody's business, but she doesn't have the strength behind any of her stripes. I would urge her to go into acting.
Yeah, maybe. It might work out better for her. Moving on really quick, obviously, huge topic of discussion. Jose Aldo proved to be incredibly tough. But I think that we all know that fight should have been stopped long before it was. And I have to throw this in there. Some may hate it. I don't really give a damn. What we saw from Jose Aldo, let's be honest. Conor McGregor, I think to me that proves his punching power inside that octagon, for one. That tells you how good of a fighter he really is. I mean, didn't he put Jose down in 13 seconds, right? Wasn't that the thing? As far as the actual fight goes, you as a fight promoter, if you're watching that thing happen, what the hell is going through your mind?
I think that he needs to step back a little bit and refocus on better fights for him. And everybody's saying, okay, this is the end of a legacy. We're going to see Jose Aldo retire. I don't think it's time for him to retire yet. I think that it's time for him to revamp his management strategies and go in with better opponents so that he can get back on top.
I'm talking about the officiating. That was horrendous. I mean, how are you letting because the rule is you have to intelligently defend yourself, right?
And for all these people that say that he needs to retire, yeah, he's going to have to retire if he takes collateral damage like that. If our officials aren't keeping our fighters safe, yeah, he's going to have to retire.
Agreed. 100% agreed. And for me, the worst part about it is there's so many factors involved right now, right? You have to think, number one, this is the only sport that's on. So it's literally all eyes on you. So when something like that happens, that's a reflection on not only the official, but the company as a whole. And then, of course, the face of that company, which is Dana White. So all those factors start to combine. Then you look at a lot of people you and I both know still don't respect the sport very much. They're only watching it because it's the only thing that's on right now. And they're looking at this and probably going, this is
$70 a pop. You have to like it somewhat.
Well, and you also have to be desperate. Let's be honest about that. And then the other factor is, like I made mention of, there are a lot of people who still believe this is nothing more than a blood sport. And then they see something like this happen. I mean, they're walking away from this going, I may never watch the UFC or any MMA ever again, which hurts promotability. And they may have gone back to Venom for whatever reason. They decided to drop Reebok, but doesn't even really matter when you are going to have a hard time promoting yourself and trying to retract everything that happened with this one damn fight where one guy's getting his ass whipped for how long now, right? A couple of minutes. I mean, that fight really should have probably been stopped in the third or fourth round. Let alone waiting until, what, midway through the fifth? Isn't that what it was? So,
it was late.
Way, way late. This thing was over.
Let's look at it from a promotional aspect.
Okay.
This is a brand new fight island. It just now got rolled out. Do you think because the fans wanted these fights to happen so much, do you think maybe the promoter went to the refs and said, let him go? I mean, promoters do that. Let them go to the brink.
Boy.
I know. I'm sorry for sharing trade secrets, but that happens.
That's huge risk-reward right there, because you were talking about the lifelong damage potentially of somebody to the brain, right? Because, I mean, the NFL got shut down because of concussions.
I think that Dana White's going to go in and say there was no coming back for him. He wasn't advancing. He wasn't defending. It should have been stopped.
Well, and here's the antithesis. Well, kind of the same thing more really than the antithesis. But, and you and I both know this, there are a lot of fighters who go into these fights that go, if I have to die in that octagon, let me do it. You know, and that's a dangerous aspect as well. And you know, you've got officials that, you know, have to kind of, you know, there's borderline and then there's egregious. And me personally, I felt like what I saw in that fight was egregious. I don't think there's any other way to word it, you know. And whether or not Dana White did that, I mean, that's speculation. And you're right, there's an ugly side to every business. But let's be honest, just sitting there on your elbows, putting your, you know, hands over your ears, is not intelligently defending yourself. And those punches went on right for a solid minute and a half, at least. You know, you can't defend yourself intelligently, you're done. And I've seen fights stop for a lot less, to be perfectly honest with you. So, right, you know, not everything is a Chech Congo situation. Right? We've all seen that comeback. Not every fight is that. And the ref was intelligent enough to see Congo rolling around, still making moves, getting out of the way, you know, and then I can't remember to this day who he was fighting, but, you know, he left himself open and Congo caught him, and that was it. But even then, more than likely, Congo was probably fighting on reflex at that moment than he was actually being cognitive. And I think that we could be honest about that as well. So I don't know. Last thing with UFC 251 here really quick. Go ahead. I'll let you finish.
Well, on the plus side, it looks like Dana White is on top of it. He released a press statement. And he said, you know, what did you guys think about it? And he said he's going to go in and talk to the refs, and they're going to get on board. Everyone's going to have a mutual understanding of what he expects. He expects that fight to have been stopped earlier. So I do think that he's being... I mean, I think that he's on top of it.
Well, and he's got to be proactive at this point. There's no other way around it. He has to be, because if not, everything that he's worked for with Fight Island goes to hell in a handbasket, you know? Right. Really quick, Max Holloway, I think we both can agree, robbed, right?
Robbed.
All the way. Come on. I don't know what the hell anybody was looking at. And you know, a lot of people are going to say, well, that's why you don't let it go to the judges. And even fighters say that. But let's be honest. Judges are there for that exact reason. And if,
what's the point in having judges?
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. That's why they're there. You know?
I mean, I scored it 3-2. I don't know what you scored it as, but he was still up.
I honestly felt like the first two rounds did not go to him. You could debate the third round, but definitely the last two went to Max. So if you want to give the third round to Max, I have no problem with it. I think that he, you know, won the last three rounds of that fight.
Right.
Period. I just don't think there's any other way around it. Okay. Moving on. Favorite sports movies. Let's start with football time. Your favorite three football movies of all time.
Are you going to put me on the spot like that?
Yeah, okay. You go first. Ladies first. My mama taught me that. So you're up, kid.
Okay. Favorite football movie? Draft Day.
Really? Draft Day?
I love Draft Day.
I mean, it's an okay movie,
but... I love the recruiting.
There's some ins and outs of that movie that are pretty good. You know, come on and say, you pancake-eating mother effer. You know, yeah, there's some ins and outs. Okay. All right. All right. What's your second? Number two.
What's my second favorite football movie?
Yes.
Man. It would either...
I thought you had this all planned out, Tom. We talked about
between
this.
Between Rudy and Any Given Sunday. Rudy's the classic. It's a rite of passage.
Okay.
Yeah, Rudy.
Okay. And so then I would gather number three, Any Given Sunday?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah. See, and I hate because that movie is so underrated, and I feel like that movie really foretold the NFL the way that we see it now. And there were so many athletes involved in that movie, right? We had Terrell Owens was in that movie. The great Jim Brown was in that movie. Athletically, I'm trying to think. There's some other names. You know, there were coaches from the NFL in that movie.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. That was just Barry Switzer made an appearance in that movie. the way that the scenes were filmed was phenomenal. I don't think that we could ever look at a game of football ever the same again. I think the XFL, in its first stint in the early 2000s, really tried to mimic that by wanting to have cameras on football players so that way they could get that same feel of the game the way that that movie captured it. I think Vince McMahon took a lot from that, more than he would maybe be willing to admit to. And it was so hardcore. Mm-hmm. And at the time, you know, you had to think, like you said, Jamie Foxx, LL Cool J, Cameron Diaz, Al Pacino, I thought, made a phenomenal football coach.
Oh, I love Al Pacino.
You know, that's actually my favorite football movie of all time, is Any Given Sunday. And people are, you know, they, so many people hate that movie. But I think if a good majority were to go back and rewatch that movie now, seeing the way the game is played, seeing the way that there are social justice
in the locker room.
Absolutely. The social justice issues that are played into it. The aspects of that. I mean, these guys are, you know, doing cocaine and, you know, drinking heavy. And it's a reality that a lot of people don't want to see in sports. It does exist. Just because you don't get caught doesn't mean it didn't happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Lawrence Taylor's another one. Boy, he was in that movie too, you know. So just, I love that movie all the way around. That's my favorite football movie of all time.
That's your favorite pick?
Yes, absolutely. My number two football movie of all time is Necessary Roughness. Maybe it's a childhood thing. I don't know what it is. Hilarious movie, severely underrated. My childhood crush, Kathy Ireland, is in that movie. Sinbad was in that movie. The dude from Quantum Leap was in that movie. I loved it, you know, because they didn't win a whole lot of football games, and at the end they beat the number one team in the nation, which happens in real life in college football. You get a rival, they're not having a good season, they've got nothing to lose, they play against somebody that's undefeated and looking to play for a national title, and they win. We've eyewitnessed that. I mean, come on, back in 2013, Baylor ran all over an undefeated Kansas State, and Baylor was, I think, 5-7 going into that football game. So it does happen, you know. So I thought that aspect of it was so great, you know, and they just needed to win a game. That's all they wanted to do, was just win a game, and they won the game of the year, which, as we all know in college football, rivalries mean so much. I love that movie. If you haven't seen it, damn sure go and watch it. And then my third favorite movie of all time, who the hell doesn't love Rudy, but I'm not going to put that in my top three, believe it or not, is actually going to be The Waterboy. And anybody who's ever seen the movie, absolutely, no, I love The Waterboy. And here's the thing about Adam Sandler's character, and I firmly believe this about his character in that movie. I think that they really base it off of the linebacker who was in a movie called The Program. Was really psycho, heard voices, you know, to get himself motivated in order to play a game of football. He would go, "What'd you say about my mama?" And people were like, "Dude, I didn't say nothing." And he would just go off the hinges, right? So I feel like a huge part of that character was derived from the movie The Program. And I think it showed the reality of sports. And that is, you don't necessarily have to be smart in order to get to college. They will push you through the system regardless of what it takes. And I think that's one of the things that movie illustrated that really got lost in translation. So I love that movie. All right. Favorite
Number one baseball movie.
Number one baseball movie. Okay, go ahead. I know you love baseball. This is your thing. So shoot from the hip.
Moneyball all day.
Really? Moneyball. It was a good movie.
Yes.
It was a good movie, right?
But, so I don't know if I've told you before, but my son is really smart with stats.
Uh huh.
So when we watch it, I mean, he just he'll pop off, and he's great at stats, and so I really liked that. It was interesting to get into that and to show him that part of the recruiting.
Oh, look at this! I have to do this right now. Apparently, it just got announced by Ariel Helwani that the BMF champion Jorge Masvidal will defend his BMF belt against Conor McGregor at UFC 253, September the 19th, in Yas Island. Yeah.
That's cool.
Is it cool?
Yeah, I guess that's cool.
Yeah, whatever. It's a fight that people want
to
see.
I really want to see him fight Kobe Covington next again. I mean, they have so much beef.
Yeah, and, you know, honestly, I'm not sure what that fight does for the UFC. It's a brand thing. It's a brand thing. That's all that is. It's
funny, Connor. I thought you were retiring.
Yeah, come on. He never retires. That fight is brand recognition, and that's all there is to it. And if Conor McGregor wins, then he's just going to end up trying to get his lightweight belt back, which obviously is on hold right now. The division is on hold anyways because of, obviously, the tragic passing of, you know, Habib's father. So that division's right on hold as it is. So really, ultimately, what's the next move other than just making a popular fight? And I personally still think that McGregor and Ferguson would be the fight to make, but what the hell do I know? So, all right. Yeah. So your son.
And I think Masvidal and Colby Covington would be the fight to make next.
But. Yeah, I agree. Your son, credible baseball statistics, and thus your favorite movie is Moneyball.
Yeah, and because the interest he showed in it, I just kind of propelled that to my favorite baseball movie. And I like recruiting.
Yeah, you mentioned that earlier with draft day. I'm starting to see a theme here from your time. your second favorite baseball movie?
Probably 42.
Great movie. Absolutely.
Third would probably be... I really like Angels in the Outfield.
I mean, that's a good movie. Who doesn't like that movie? You know. But here's the thing. I gotta admit, how in the hell is Sandlot not in your top three? Really, really? Time the Sandlot nowhere.
I think I burned myself out on it.
But that doesn't mean it's not a great movie, though.
It is a great movie.
Okay. Well, for me, number one is the Sandlot. All right. Okay. For me, number two was Rookie of the Year. I love that movie, man.
Good one.
Yes, absolutely. And then the other one, you know what? I'm going to be honest with you. Probably Angels in the Outfield. I actually just watched it the other day. There's some stuff in there religiously that I don't
necessarily. How is Major League not in your top three?
Well, it wasn't in yours either, so you can't really go after me for that. But here's the thing about Major League. That's kind of like Major League, I think, was made to demonstrate the forgetfulness of pro athletes when it comes to money and having fun. And I think that The Sandlot and Rookie of the Year embrace both of those ideas so perfectly. And the other thing about it, about those two movies, is they do a great a great job of showing the contrast and comparison, especially in Rookie of the Year. Because remember, Chet Stedman, the character, is sitting in the car after he gets released, and he says, "Take care of your gift because one day it will be gone." That's the reality of an athlete getting older, easily replaced, and you have no idea what's next. You didn't think about your future.
And it's a hard concept to grasp.
Yeah.
Usually you're living in the moment and you don't think ahead 10 years.
Why would you?
You think, I'm on the top of my game.
Right.
This is it. This is going to last me forever.
Exactly. You're 25. You're making millions.
You expect it to end. And you're 30 without a 401. You know, it's crazy.
Right. No, I agree. I agree. You wake up one day and it's just not there anymore. And how do you cope with that? I remember watching John Elway when he retired, and the exact words that he said out loud were, "I just can't do it physically anymore." And he started to cry, and he said, "And that's hard for me to say." It is the reality that you as an athlete can no longer physically handle, or capable, whatever the case may be, or combination of what you are expected to do when you are in the field of play, period. Mm-hmm. And it gives up on us all. We all have our prime, and once it's gone, that's it. Okay, so we've done baseball, basketball time. I would love to hear your three favorite basketball movies of all time.
Ooh, you're going to think this is crazy. I really like Coach Carter.
Love that movie.
Let's see. I'm gonna think of number two. You kind of put me on the spot here. Let's cage.
What do you mean on the spot time? You've had 2.5 weeks to prepare for this.
I've had Corona. I'm gonna ride that excuse out for a little while.
I'll bet you are. It's only gonna take you so far though, time. I mean, legitimately.
I like Coach Carter. I'm gonna think of number two. Give me a second.
Oh boy.
Tell me your favorite.
My favorite basketball movie of all time is Blue Chips.
Is what?
Blue Chips.
I don't think I've seen that.
Probably not. Most haven't, to be perfectly honest with you. It had Shaquille O'Neal, Penny Hardaway, Nick Nolte, and it was really exposing the dirty measures that it takes to recruit, which is something that you love so much, in college athletics. And the funny part to me is, I don't know if it's funny, but definitely the coincidence, is that there's a conversation that's happening where he was recruiting one of the guys, and he decides that he's not happy. Then, where matter of fact, it's Penny Hardaway's character who's not happy anymore. And he makes a phone call to the guy that did all this dirty stuff with him. And he goes, his mother got a job and he got a house with a lawn. A lawn. That's what happened to Reggie Bush when he was at USC. His mother got a job. They got a house with a lawn. I mean, it couldn't have been more telling of how college recruiting can work in the dirty aspect of the business, you know?
Right.
And, of course, I mean, at the time, Shaq and Penny, you know, playing on the same team together, two really huge stars. You've got Nick Nolte, who just gives off that coach vibe 100%. The yelling, the cussing, the screaming, you know, the authenticity of that game that they played at the end. You've got Bobby Hurley, who was at Duke. You got Bobby Knight involved, you know. Now I'm trying to think who else was involved in that movie. Rick Pitino, you know, legendary coach in the eyes of many, despite some of the off-the-field or off-the-court scandals that he's had for recruiting, by the way. So, I mean, there's just a lot there. I mean, I thought that movie told exactly what goes on in the world of sports for college athletics. And, you know, yeah. Eric Dickerson will tell you, if you're not cheating, you're not trying. So.
Okay, I got to watch that movie.
Yeah, you really do. It's a damn good movie. My second favorite basketball movie of all time would definitely be Hoop Dreams. Read the book when I was in sixth grade. Love the book, love the movie. Just a phenomenal story through and through. You know, when you're coming up in the streets, there are a lot of things that you can get involved in, or you can go another direction. So, you know, it just all kind of depends, you know, on what your aspirations are.
Go ahead.
Well, you didn't even pick out a first.
Wait, I said Coach Carter.
Oh, wait. Yeah, you did. Okay, my bad. Go ahead. Number two.
Yeah. Okay, so my second would have to be Love and Basketball. I love that movie. That movie is so raw, and it's about new talent and, you know, these kids that have their whole lives ahead of them. They've got this great gift, and they can do anything they want to do, and both of them are kind of clawing their way up. It's a cool movie for me.
You know, a lot of people liked it. I didn't. I don't know. Especially the lady audience. I think you could almost label that a chick flick, to be honest with you. I think you really could. I think you could really label Love and Basketball as a chick flick. But I love the build in their relationship, though. And then, of course, you know, the ending, really sad. But
well, I don't know if you noticed, but I'm kind of a chick. So
a little bit. A little bit, time. I would say if I had to pick out a third favorite basketball movie, you know, so many people, you know, I don't know that you would call this a basketball movie, but it had Tupac. Bonus points here if you know what I'm talking about. Come on, time.
Are you talking about who?
No, He Got Game is not with Tupac. That's with Denzel Washington and Ray Allen.
Oh, Okay.
Come on.
Okay. Well, what is it? No, you would tell me. Tupac.
Damn it, Tom. It's called Above the Rim. All right. And
oh, my God. I'm so mad at myself for not remembering that.
Yeah, you've got to. I love that movie.
But it still wouldn't be in my top three.
Well, see, and to me, Above the Rim is very much along the lines of Hoop Dreams. You know, you've got a lot of choices to make, and it's the reality. You know, people think that you don't necessarily have to join a gang. You don't even know that you're doing it while you're doing it. That's the thing about it. You know, you're given these things, and you think that they're for free, and then you find out nothing in this life is for free. And, you know, who better to play that role at the time than Tupac, for one. For two, you had the backstory of this other kid's brother whose friend died while they were playing basketball. He lived with that guilt for his entire life about what happened. You know, you've got Bernie Mac playing a guy who had a great future in front of him. He becomes an addict and can no longer do any of the things that he used to. He's getting made fun of. He's being called a bum. People don't know how to treat him because he's different, you know, and they think that he just became this person because that's always who he was. That's not the case. There's just so many great dramatic elements of that movie that I don't know. I love movies that I feel depict the realistic version of something, in case you haven't seen my theme yet. And so for all of my movies, for the most part, obviously with, you know, the outside of that being Angels in the Outfield, I really like movies that I think tell a very semi-realistic story. You know, and that's a very, how much more realistic can it get than that?
Well, you know? I like sports movies that take these athletes out of their comfort zone and force them to take on a character that's entertaining for the audience and pulls in mainstream audience and turns them into fans. So my third pick would be Space Jam.
Dude, Space Jam was such a fun movie.
Michael Jordan was so good.
Yeah. Whatever happened, by the way? I thought LeBron was like on the set of the next Space Jam. They were talking about that movie for years, doing it with LeBron James. I've seen nothing of it other than a couple of alleged photos of this dude filming it. And I don't know. But I am with you on Space Jam. That would probably be like top 7 or 8, though, to be honest with you. You know? I mean, you know, Looney Tunes. You know, that's kind of more our age type thing, though.
Yeah. I think I probably watched it every day after school for a year straight.
Could have been. I'll be honest. I had a jersey and a pair of shorts on layaway at Walmart. Never got them.
Oh.
I know. I wish to this day I had it because I can only imagine what it would be worth. You know?
Right.
All right, really quick here, time. Your experience with COVID-19. First of all, like I said, I'm glad you're doing better. Your symptoms and what you went through personally with the virus.
Well, you know, it got hairy for about 2 days, and I thought, we probably need to go to the hospital. My ex-husband brought his mom over here, and he said, we're here to take you to the hospital. I said, nope. I'm going to let you know when it's time, and it's not time. So June 26th, I had a sinus headache. I had it for 2 days. I took Tylenol. I couldn't kick it. I took aspirin. I couldn't kick it. So then June 29th, I had a sore throat. So on June 30th, I said, I'm going to go ahead and get tested. Went home. They sent me home from work. You know, don't come back until you have a test. So I didn't get my results for a week, which meant no 4th of July for me. I sat in my car and watched fireworks. And I was staying at the big fireworks place here in Oklahoma. So I was quarantined from everyone. And then by the time I got my positive result, I was already out of the woods. So the 3rd and the 4th of July is when it was the worst. I was running a fever. I was coughing. I had my sinus headache. I couldn't smell it. I still can't smell or taste anything. Mm. But then on the 6th, when I got my test results, I already felt at 90%.
But then I thought I saw you on Facebook where you said you felt like it kind of came back and hit you all over again, right?
I had waves. I had waves here and there where one day I'd say, all right, I feel good. By the end of the day, I was depleted of energy.
Wow.
And that went on for about a week from that 30th until the 5th is probably that waves where it just kind of came and went. I kept on fighting it off with emergency. I boiled different herbs on the stove to open up my airways. I ate so many oranges, so many vitamins. I just tried to keep it at bay.
Was there anything, did they give you any medications? Did they make mention of doing any shots? I mean, what did your doctors tell you in terms of taking care of yourself?
No, they said if you feel bad, you can take an allergy pill, and it'll help open your nasal cavity. Mm. But as far as any medicine, it's basically treating the symptoms. And I've heard a lot that people that have passed with COVID have had ibuprofen in their system. There's something that reacts with the COVID, and it just doesn't. I mean, it helps close that airway.
Wow.
So I've steered away from ibuprofen. But mainly, it's just trying to build your immune system to fight it off. We have everything on this earth to fight whatever diseases or infections that we come across, but we just have to know how to treat things.
Well, I got to tell you,
pharmaceuticals.
Well, and I know what you're saying, home, holistic medications, herbs, things like that, preventative measures. Obviously is admittedly so, somebody who's a smoker, I can only imagine, getting this thing and the inability to breathe already as it is, the weight gain that I suffered through, the quarantine after dropping 20 pounds and now having easily gained all of it back, there's just a lot there. And, I think that
it's funny. I've gained 12 pounds during this quarantine time, and I can't smell or taste anything. So tomorrow I'm starting an all liquid diet, and I'm going to do that for 3 days, and then do my high protein.
Did you feel hungry at all? I mean, because if you gained the weight, clearly you were eating.
It's not about feeling hungry; it's just about keeping yourself busy.
Yeah, well,
I think that's what it was.
There's that too. I've heard that like taking naps and trying to sleep a lot doesn't really do anything. In fact, I've read where some doctors are telling people to stay awake throughout the day and let your body kind of naturally fight this thing off. Is that what you were told, or?
Well, and if you have, no, I nap. I'm a napper. I'm a professional napper. I can nap in 20 minutes to wake up and be ready for the day. I would walk my dog and I'd get lots of sun. You can't tell from this complexion, but I have been out trying to do things. Try not to stay in one place too long. But if you do have like shortness of breath, you feel tension on your chest where your airway is constricted, it's best to try to sleep in a lazy boy, a recliner, something where you're inclined so that fluid can't build and kind of lay on your chest and float in it all night. So if you can incline your pillows 3 deep or lay in a recliner, that would help with your shortness of breath.
Mm. So basically prop your neck up in any way that you can. So that way it all just drains. Right?
Right.
Instead of giving it an opportunity to just lay there stagnantly while you sleep or whatever. Is that right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Well, regardless, time, I'm definitely glad that you're doing better. I was definitely worried about you. Good to see you and your family all doing okay. And especially, I mean, because you're in Oklahoma, and they've had spikes as well. Obviously, not to the level that Florida or other places have had, but, look, I know there's a lot of people out there that are calling this scamdemic. They think it's a hoax. Look, I'm not going to tell you that it's as high up in the numbers as they say that it is. I'm not going to tell you that as many people pass as they say that they do. I'm not going to get into all that. I'm going to tell you that I know somebody who's definitely had it, and it really exists, and we just need to be careful, period.
And isn't it funny? My kids didn't leave my side. Neither did my dog. And none of them have tested positive. I've had them tested twice. All of them negative.
Weird.
So not the dog. I mean, she's fine, though.
That is really
but
weird.
But my kids have all tested negative. So it's funny that we've been in close quarters, and neither one of us or neither one of them have gotten sick.
Well, that's probably a good thing, though, Thyme. All right, everybody. She is Thyme Doonkeen. I am simply Drew Duncan. Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram is all at Duncan Doonkeen. Do not forget that you can find us wherever you are listening to the podcast. Simply tell your device to play Drew Duncan, or pardon me, Duncan and Doonkeen on iHeart, Spreaker, Google, Apple. We are wherever you are listening to podcasts. And as always, don't you dare touch that dial.